Welcome to Talks at GS, and it's my pleasure today to have a great historian with us to discuss his new book, Presidents of War. So Michael Beschloss and I have known each other for a long time, and if you followed his history and have looked at the various publications that he's done, 9 books, the programs, appearances on television, what he consistently tweets out, all the activities that he has done around that, it is really quite remarkable. Maybe I could start with why presidents of war, not presidents at war. What's the distinction here?
Well, one reason is that the book is largely about how 8 or 9 presidents got us into major wars through 200 years. And what I was trying to do is, you know, began with the idea that only 8 or 9 people in American history have had this experience of sending large numbers of Americans to risk their lives, put their lives in harm's way, and what did they have in common? And it turns out that these very different people from James Madison through Lyndon Johnson and beyond, there were some things they actually turned out to have in common. One is that every single one of them became more religious in the course of being war leaders. Abraham Lincoln, for instance, when he was a young man in Illinois, was a skeptic, thought of as an agnostic, but when he was late in the Civil War, he was visited by an old friend from Illinois who found Lincoln reading the Bible and was astounded, and Lincoln said, "I can't imagine how any president could have this experience of causing the deaths of so many people without finding some kind of spiritual comfort." I talked to Lyndon Johnson's wife, Lady Bird, late in her life, and she was talking about how much LBJ agonized over the fact that there were so many young Americans dying in Vietnam. And their daughter, Lucy, had converted to Catholicism. They were Protestants, converted to Catholicism when she was about 16, and she began taking LBJ secretly to a small Catholic church in Washington, D.C., and Lady Bird told me that late in the Vietnam War, she really thought that there was a good chance that LBJ would become a Catholic because he was getting such comfort in the midst of all of his troubles.
One of the key elements of the book is presidents who are going to war and under what authorities. So if you look at the last time in the United States a president actually went and asked Congress or the authority to go to war.
1942. Have we had any wars since 1942?
Yes.
So a little bit of a problem because, as John is suggesting, the founders, when they wrote the Constitution, they were really worried that, like kings of England or dictators in Europe, the presence of the United States in the future might take us into wars that were not absolutely necessary and maybe didn't have absolute public support and might do so for political reasons to make themselves more popular. And so that's why, anyone here read the Constitution lately? Last 24 hours, even better. Constitution says if anyone wants a war, Congress has to declare it. And so that's the reason they did that, was to sort of lock the door against presidents who wanted to get us into wars single-handedly or almost overnight. But in recent times, Congress has sort of given up and presidents have taken us into wars without that kind of sanction of a war declaration.
So if we look at the progression, presidents have chosen to go by a form of resolution. So why has the Congress allowed that to happen? I suppose you could say the restraint came into play with the Wars Powers Act.
Right.
But what, to this day, conflicts are still entered into
on the basis of these resolutions. It's because presidents felt that if they have to ask Congress to declare war, that puts members of Congress on the hook. So if the war gets to be unpopular, the voters are going to go to the members of Congress and say, "Why did you vote for this war declaration? You're a terrible person. You should be driven out of office." And so as a result, members of Congress prefer these resolutions to use force. That's what was done for Iraq and Afghanistan, Persian Gulf War. Vietnam War was fought on nothing but something called a Gulf of Tonkin resolution, which was based on an incident that really never took place, at least as Lyndon Johnson claimed. And the problem with this is that if you have a war declaration, you know, members of Congress are forced to be there on the takeoff, and they have the responsibility if the war gets to be unpopular. If it's just a resolution, they can claim, and I'm sure many of you have heard this with members of Congress with Afghanistan and Iraq, well, I was just voting for a resolution to use force. I never had an idea that this would turn into a war. You know, what a terrible president to have abused this resolution. So what you want is Congress signed on.
You know, one of the presidents in the book that you talk about is James Polk. And you look at the different goals, you quite notably talk about Polk as being a liar, a cheat, a bully.
Scoundrel also.
In terms of that, and you look at the broad objectives in the Mexican War that he entered into, but his ultimate plan was to make the United States this continental nation. His ultimate plan was to secure this sort of border. Was that a higher purpose, or was that a just political expedience of the moment?
Whenever you're looking at presidents or leaders, you're always looking at ends versus means. You know, you've served with a number of these leaders, a lot of things that you did admire, some of the things you didn't, and sometimes they do good things, but maybe in ways that you would have preferred not to see. So Polk's a great example. Polk fabricated an incident on the Texas border and got Mexicans to attack. It was a tiny incident. So then Polk went to Congress and said, we need a major war against Mexico, all the way down to Mexico City. It lasted about a year and a half, or a little bit less than that. But the point is that Polk had an ulterior motive, and the ulterior motive was he wanted something that was a good thing, which is to add almost 1 million square miles of territory to the United States so that we would be a continental nation from the Atlantic to the Pacific. And the problem here is that, you know, when our country was founded, the idea of our founders was that this would be a city on the hill, that we would tell the truth. Presidents would tell the truth to Congress. So here is Polk only 60 years after the Constitution, lying to Congress, lying to his own Secretary of State, faking an incident in Texas. And one of the very few who rose up against this was this young congressman from Illinois called Abraham Lincoln. And Lincoln, in 1847, rose up and said, I don't think this incident ever happened, and I think presidents should not lie. It's what you really wanted a young congressman to say, but very few people did, because Polk was making an argument that later presidents did too, which is, you criticize a president, you're really criticizing the soldiers in the field. And that's intimidating to a lot of people, especially members of Congress, then and now.
You often talk about, you know, those who do not remember the past are condemned to repeat it. But I looked at this and found it's amazing how many stories are about incidents being manipulated to have outcomes, how people have value of the moment for the political purposes and then no longer of value throughout this book. Maybe we can start with Wilson in World War
I. Yeah, you're totally right. That Wilson, who by early 1917 wanted to get involved in World War I, helping to make sure that the British won and defeated the Germans, used something called the Zimmerman telegram that was an intercepted telegram to say that unless we Americans join this war, the Germans will come and defeat us and make the Western Hemisphere a German hemisphere. He didn't particularly believe it, but it was a good way of mobilizing Americans to get involved in war. Everyone know about the sinking of the USS Maine in Havana Harbor? We got into war against Spain because of the sinking of the Maine, which people attributed to Spain. Turns out there was ample reason to believe what was actually the case, which was the Maine was sunk by a boiler incident, but you can't go to war against boilers, so we went against Spain. And it did have a good end. We became a world power for the first time. But that encouraged someone like Lyndon Johnson in 1964, when he got a report that there had been an attack on an American vessel in the Gulf of Tonkin. He immediately goes on TV and says, there's been an unprovoked attack against an American ship, and he got Congress to pass a resolution, Gulf of Tonkin resolution, on which he and Nixon fought the whole Vietnam War, which killed almost 60,000 Americans. So the problem here is, it's not just it's a bad thing for presidents to lie and to trick Americans into wars that they may or may not support if they knew what was the real reason, but the problem is it casts doubt on a president when he wants to get into wars for the right reasons.
Well, let's turn to Lincoln. You touch upon in the book, in fact, I think it's a theme through the chapter on Lincoln, is the degree in which he brought to himself that death and destruction. He lived the consequences of his actions by mandating certain things. How do you explain what he was attempting to do? Why did he choose to do that? You know, I've recently read a story that talked about George W. Bush, that his desire to paint veterans wounded in the conflict, you know, is you know, that people have, I'm not trying to be a psychiatrist here, but that people have talked about that as being his way of real, you know, understanding the consequences of his decision too. So I wonder if you could start with Lincoln.
And it tells us good things about George W. Bush, I think, because a lot of people might say if they had been president and that had happened, I don't want to remember those things. It tells us a lot good about him that he does want to remember them. And it's shared a little bit with Abraham Lincoln, because Lincoln, when there began to be huge casualties in the Civil War, he was told by his aides, there's so many people dying that we need a new national cemetery. And Lincoln said, build it next to my summer house. Because he said, I'm making all these decisions, they're causing so many people to die, I don't want to get disconnected from the results of those decisions. And he said, I want to see the Union graves being dug every day. It'd be intensely painful to me, but it will remind me of the consequences of these terrible decisions that I'm making. That's what you want from a president. You want a president with empathy. He would tell a young friend of his from Illinois, a friend of his youth who came to see him, he said, can you imagine I, who cannot even stand watching a chicken being slaughtered, here I am responsible for oceans of blood. I think empathy is a very important quality in a president. You compare that to Richard Nixon, who sporadically was upset by some of the cases he heard of the people who were dying in Vietnam under his orders, but Nixon once said, I don't want to get too emotionally involved in knowing about what's happening as the result of these decisions of mine, almost the opposite of Lincoln's. He once said, you know, I want it to be almost like playing chess. I think that did not serve him very well.
And what about President Franklin Roosevelt? Because, you know, I remember that, and I think you quoted here, his fireside chat in which he told his listeners that, you know, your government has unmistakable confidence in your ability to hear the worst without flinching or losing heart.
Perfect example of the way a president should operate. Polar opposite would be Lyndon Johnson in 1965, and I love LBJ for voting rights and civil rights and Medicare and some other things. Not the most fiscally responsible human being on earth, but he did some good things. One thing he did really bad was he started big American involvement in the Vietnam War while secretly, from the very beginning, thinking we could not win. And one of the worst moments I encountered was beginning of 1965, LBJ is sending huge numbers of American soldiers off to die in Vietnam for the first time. And he goes to the bases and he says, America wins the wars that we fight, and go nail the coonskin to the wall and things like this. And in private, he's on the telephone with his defense secretary, a guy named Robert McNamara. And Johnson says to his defense secretary, it's the beginning of the war, I can't think of anything worse than losing the war in Vietnam, and I do not see any way that I can win, that we can win. This is the beginning of the war in 1965. And by that summer, he's saying to his wife, Lady Bird, about being the commander in chief during Vietnam, I feel as if I'm in a plane that's crashing, and I do not have a parachute. President of the United States at a beginning of a war where young Americans are being forced to go die. And I cannot think of anything worse than a president not leveling with the American people about the fact that at the very beginning of the war, he is doubtful that it can be ever be won. So that's why, in contrast, I honor Roosevelt for doing what you're talking about, which is going on the radio and saying, we may go through many months of setbacks, and in the end, I think we'll win, but be prepared for some bad times before then.
And do you think that Roosevelt is very much like Lincoln in terms of being quite politically astute in the relative list of the presidents that you look to? Is it the same degree?
I do, and also he was guided by history. Would there be anyone here who thinks that it's a bad thing for a leader to know history or to read books? You know, I mean, Harry Truman once said, not every reader will be a leader, but every leader has to be a reader. And it's a nice story because Truman, I think you'll agree with this, John, I don't think there was any president who knew more presidential history than Truman. Truman grew up, he was poor, thick glasses, parents said no sports because we can't replace the glasses. So Truman said, as a result, I read every book in the Independence, Missouri Public Library, which I always thought was an exaggeration until I went to Independence and it's not a very big library, so he probably did. But the thing is that Truman felt that he could not be president without knowing history, not because he had to know names or dates, but the way I would put it is, if you're not interested in history, perfectly fine, but it means that your life experience will be limited to what's happened to you and what people you know tell you, and that's about it. If you tap into history in some way, whether it's movies or books or some other way, you're tapping into the collective wisdom of billions of people. You know, if you've got a president, you want someone to know where earlier presidents and earlier generations of Americans have succeeded or failed.
Well, that's actually a good point to turn to writing of history. As I said at the outset, 9 books that you've done. But what about the ability to write about presidents in the future? I mean, more and more, the record is getting smaller and smaller. The things that you rely on today to do your work, letters, long memos, diaries, they're not going to exist for presidents.
That's the problem because, you know, like if I'm writing about Franklin Roosevelt, his wife Eleanor wrote thousands of letters and some of them were 20 pages long and she pours her heart into them. Like in one letter, she's writing about her marriage and she says, more and more I think of that Franklin is a great man, but he treats me like a stranger. Doesn't that tell you a lot about that marriage, even if you didn't know very much about it? And the problem is, how many here write 20-page emails pouring your heart out, telling about your emotions? So, you know, once one of you becomes president and I have to write about you, or I have the pleasure of writing about you and the honor, we're not going to have sources like that. You know, I've been talking about the fact that Lyndon Johnson made these tapes of his private conversations. Do you know all about those? LBJ, from the first day he was president, if you called him on the telephone, he would oftentimes have tape recorder hooked up that would be recording both of you. And this is a horrible violation of civil liberties, but for a historian, it's a gold mine. Because you can hear exactly what he said, and in the background, you know, you can hear what he was watching loudly on TV. It was a Western called Gunsmoke he liked, so you can hear the pistols firing as he's talking to people about the Vietnam War. But you find out a lot that's really important. Remember I was saying about him talking to McNamara about not knowing whether the Vietnam War could be won. Problem is nowadays, these kind of sources are not kept by a president. They don't keep diaries, they don't write letters. Their lawyers tell them, keep your paper trail as modest as possible because it might be leaked to newspapers or there might be a special prosecutor. Well, that's the advice every president has gotten for at least the last 40 years. And, you know, sure enough, our current president, things are leaked to newspapers and there is a special prosecutor. So there's a huge pressure on every modern president to keep a paper trail minimal. That was true of Barack Obama, it was true of George W. Bush. It's getting worse and worse. And the problem for an historian is, what are we going to write these books from? Press releases in the future? It's a real problem. I mean, some people say you can use emails. Well, yes, they can tell you a little bit, but don't make up for the letters. Maybe Twitter. If I were writing, let's say, about President Trump or President Obama 40 years from now, Twitter tells you a lot about the way the public is reacting to a president, but it's not going to tell you a huge amount about what was going on in the president's mind that you did not know about at the time, and that's what we really need.
Now, we have here a series, Letters to Our Younger Self, which we run. And in terms of that category of advice, what was the best advice that you ever received in, you know, pursuing your own career?
I studied under a wonderful historian called James McGregor Burns, which perhaps some of you have read. We can clap for. I certainly do. Who passed in his 90s just a few years ago. And I wanted to do this since I was 10 years old, write history books about presidents. And I said to him, you know, well, if I'm going to write books, you know, do I need to teach as well? That's what historians usually do. I don't think, you know, I see people like you who heroically teach at the same time as you heroically write history books. I think I'd like to write history books, but I don't know if I could teach as well, and especially doing it at the same time. And the advice he gave me was, why don't you become a foundation executive with the idea that you could write history on the side and they would encourage that? And so I said, well, how do you do that? And he said, well, why don't we send you to Harvard Business School? So as much as it may seem to be a non sequitur, I went to Harvard Business School and I got an MBA with the idea that that would equip me to become a foundation executive and be able to do what I wanted in life, which is to write history. As it happened, my senior thesis at Williams College was published as my first book. I was 24 years old. It reads like a book written by someone 24 years old, but it was enough that I got hired by the Smithsonian Institution as an historian and have been writing nearly full-time ever since, which I think is probably a good thing for me and also for the foundation world. So I had a great time at Harvard Business School, but in retrospect, I'm probably the most useless alum of Harvard Business School who ever lived.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, that concludes our time for today's session.
Thank you, Adam. Thank you for being here.